Next speaker is Manuel Chakravarti. Manuel has a long and esteemed also career in functional programming. So I mentioned about Michelle being heavily involved with development OCaml. So Manuel here has a long history of developing and driving and being a co-designer of Haskell. So, and he's worked at UNSW, is presently actually chief engineer, I think, on Plutus with Phil Wadler. So there's a lot of things you're doing. You're also one of the authors of one of the popular Haskell development platforms. So it's great to have you here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you also for inviting me. Thank you, everybody, for coming. I'd like to introduce our novel smart contract platform, Plutus, which we are deploying on the Cardano blockchain to you. And so let's get started by talking a little bit about Cardano before we get to Plutus. Now, this term of a third generation blockchain, meaning beyond the legacy systems like Bitcoin and Ethereum that we've got, has come up a few times here now. And Cardano is one of these third generation systems. And another topic which we've heard about before, which often comes up in this conversation, is how do you achieve consensus? And Cardano also is firmly rooted in the opinion that we don't want to waste our precious energy, especially in the current time where climate change is one of the biggest threats to humanity. We don't want to waste an unnecessary amount of energy on solving pointless cryptographic puzzles just to agree on which block should come next on a virtual blockchain. So in these proof of stake systems, for example, it has been shown a Cardano node can run on a RockPi device. That's one of these little small one chip computers. And that's obviously a lot less energy than having a mining farm somewhere at a waterfall in China. But there are other priorities to Cardano as well, around governance and scalability and so on, which I don't want to touch on today. What I'm really interested in speaking about today is about research and functional programming. I mean, we are in this beautiful hall of the university, so I think all of us share this interest in a system which is founded on fundamental science, on good methodology. But if you want to build such a system, there's always this big question. You've got this paper. This is very far from being a product, and we've just heard it. The time scales at which scientists think are different to the time scales that engineers or product folks think in. And so how can we match them up? How can we have a systematic process where we move newfound understanding from science into actual product? If we want to build technology which is based on the latest scientific findings, we have to answer this question. And what we are doing, we've got a few steps towards a somewhat systematic approach. So it all starts with the research paper. So this is the original paper on Ouroboros, which is the proof of stake consensus protocol underlying Cardano. But there are in fact quite a few more papers on it. This has been the first one. We have papers on things like sidechains, on domain-specific smart contract languages for financial contracts. That's step one. That's the science. And if you're interested in all the scientific output of IHK, well, I posted the URL here for you to see. But then how do we get towards a product to code? Well, we use a stepping stone, namely formal methods. What are formal methods? Formal methods is a rigorous discipline, mathematical discipline, using math to characterize what these research results are, what these algorithms are, and make a first step towards implementing them. And for that, we use functional programming. So a formal specification my clicker doesn't like me, can look like this. It's a simple mathematical equations which are readable to anybody with, let's say, high school math understanding. And then we take these equations and we turn them into code. Well, this is Haskell code, and if you don't know Haskell, then you'll be it will take you a while to read through it. But for a halfway competent Haskell program, it's quite clear these lines, they actually do the same thing. The mathematical language and this piece of functional code, they are syntactically different, but semantically they express the same thing. So what that means that from this mathematical specification, a programmer can convince themselves that they're actually implementing the same thing. This is not an efficient Haskell implementation of that specification, but it's one which behaves in the same manner in which we can run. And this holds for the sub-computations as well, which are also part of this formalization. And if we look at the Haskell code for those, again, the Haskell code is a bit more verbose, a bit more special symbols, but it's, if you know Haskell, quite easy to see the correspondence. So that's step two. So we've started with the paper, we've gone through mathematical specification, and then we are at code which reads quite similar to the specification, which we can run already. We can test it. We can look at whether it actually does what we want it to from a product point of view. And then we continue with our functional programming toolbox, and we go from this specification-like, high-level executable prototype, and we add the things that you need to add to a code base in order to make it robust production code. You have to deal with incremental computations, with rollbacks, you need a network layer, databases, all these mechanics of developing an actual product. Now we have two pieces of Haskell code. We have the executable specification, and we have the much more long-winded code which does all the database, networking, whatever. And now we use a technique, also from functional programming, called property-based testing, where we use encodings of properties that we want the system to have, and we run both systems on the same inputs, and we check that they do the same thing. So for blockchain, for example, you would want to take your prototype, your real implementation, a sequence of blocks, randomly generated, run them through both systems, and they should all end up with the same results of who owns what, right? That's what you would expect. That's a property we want to hold for these systems. So in this way, using this approach, we can go from a research paper turning the specification into a prototype functional implementation into functional production code in a manner that we can have a reasonable high guarantee of assurance that the final system is actually doing what's in the research paper. So this is a fundamental way in which we are working at IHK. Now, let's move to contracts and how we are using functional programming there, and how we are using a similar approach there. So the Pluto system, which I want to introduce, is centered around three core goals. And I'd like to discuss all three in sequence. So let's look at this functional programming thing, which has been come up a few times here, and type systems, which have also prominently featured in the previous talk, for good reasons. So what's this functional programming about? I know some of you are functional programming experts, but maybe not everybody. So let's talk about why are we going on about functional programming. Well, what's a function? A function is a mapping, mathematically speaking, from some set of inputs to a set of outputs. But not all functions are equal in this day and age where even C programmers write functions, because their functions are not really functions in the mathematical sense. So if we want to be very clear about this, we call those functions, which you know from math, we call them pure functions, meaning the relation between inputs and outputs fully characterizes the function. There are no side effects. If you call the function twice on the same inputs, you get the same outputs, guaranteed. Now, we are not only interested in this purity property, we are also interested in characterizing what these inputs and outputs can be. And that's where type systems come into play. In a modern type system, you have an additional language where you can say what inputs are permissible and then a promise at what outputs will you get if you adhere to the inputs, and the compiler is going to make sure you do that. So this allows us to use functions safely. All right, that's all nice and abstract, but what's the outcome? The outcome is that humans, with our puny little brains, that we can more easily reason about these complex systems. Software systems are some of the most complex systems which humanity has built. They're big, complicated, but we only can look at a screen full of code at a time. So it's super important that by looking at this bit of code which you can see and the little bit of memory you've got about other parts, that this is enough to reason about the code with confidence. And that's what local reasoning gives you. And local reasoning you get from this property of pure functions and having strong types. That's why it's simpler to reason about these programs. And incidentally, this is also really good for formal verification if you have the resources to do that. And it gives us a way to design our systems following these types. And in addition to verification, it also helps with testing using this property-based testing approach. So finally, the upshot is it's easier to understand code behavior, which in turn makes it easier to find code. Exploits. Does this mean all programs are going to be correct? No. Security is always a number game. It's always a probability game. What our aim is to make it more likely that the code does what we want to do, or the other way around, less likely that there are going to be any faults. And anybody who's ever going to promise you perfect security is lying. So how do we use this? On the chain, we have a calculus called Bluetooth Core, which we use to store smart contract code on the chain. And it's not a bytecode like classically in Ethereum or Bitcoin, but it's a typed functional programming calculus. Hence, we don't need an actual virtual machine. We use something called an abstract interpreter, which I'll show you in a second. And the language we are using is, it's called System F Omega. It's a calculus which has been around for quite a long time. It's been studied in theoretical computer science. So we have a fairly good understanding what it does, much better than for your average bytecode or virtual machine. And this is actually the entire semantics of Bluetooth Core in the form of an abstract machine. And if you look at our implementation, which you can do because all the code is open source on GitHub, then you'll see a one-to-one corresponding, again, between the implementation and those rules. In fact, these rules we have using Unicode as comments on top of the individual equations in the implementation. So you can check we do really the same thing in code as we do in this specification. But we are not done here. What we also did, we used ACTA, which is a dependently typed programming language / theorem prover, to formalize the meta theory of Bluetooth Core. And we are working to use this ACTA implementation in our testing pipeline to make sure that we don't only have this eyeball correctness between looks like it does the same thing, but we actually have formal proof that the meta theory of the language is what we claim it is, and that we have high confidence by testing validation that the implementation adheres to these semantics. All right, so this is how we use functional programming. Let's start to talk about the ledger. Now, classically, a ledger is something where some people have some funds And then maybe Alice transfers some funds to Bob, and Bob to Charlie. But really what we are interested in is who's got what at the end of the day. Now, this is how you structure your bank account, maybe, but there's an alternative way to do it, which was introduced by Bitcoin. It is more modeled on how cash works. So maybe Alice has this 100 ADA. ADA is the currency of the Cardano blockchain. Alice has this 100 ADA, and now she wants to pay 42 to Bob. So she actually has to split it. And then Bob can take the funds he received from Alice and take part of that to pay Charlie. So we get this network of funds flowing through the system, and this is called the UTXO or unspent transaction output representation of a ledger. And this is what is used, as I said, which was pioneered in Bitcoin, it's used in Cardano. And it has quite an impact on when you think about smart contracts. Why? Well, this data structure on the left-hand side, the UTXO structure, is a data flow graph, inherently functional data structure. Whereas the other one, an account-based model, remember maybe object-oriented programming, first year of computing, accounts were like, it's a popular model, example to illustrate object-oriented programming. So it's a more an imperative object-oriented model. And why is this important? Well, object-oriented imperative models are based on mutable state. And if people mention concurrency, distribution, and mutable state in one sentence, run. Anybody who's ever debugged a program like this can attest to that. But what about smart contracts? Well, Bitcoin uses this UTXO model, and Ethereum uses the account-based model, and really, contracts on Bitcoin are barely existent, whereas those on Ethereum, they are complicated enough that you can write great exploits and lose a lot of money. So wouldn't it be great if you could have the expressiveness of Ethereum with the clarity and functional structure of Bitcoin? So how can we get to that? Let's have a look at how the Bitcoin system, UTXO system, set up. So you've got a transaction. Transaction has inputs and outputs. Now, if you want to have a second transaction, you want to spend from the first, there's a condition called a validity condition, which you have to satisfy. For this validity condition, you have to know the output contains the value you want to spend and a piece of code. In our case, this is represented in Pluto's core, which we call the validator, which checks that you have permission to spend those funds or make that transaction. And the spending transaction has also a piece of code called the redeemer, or in Bitcoin, it's called the witness. And now we do a very simple operation. The validator is actually a function. We apply the function to the redeemer, evaluate, and if the result is true, good to go, otherwise, no. That's very simple, it's very localized, again, easy to reason about, but it's also not very powerful because the validator has no context except the redeemer to determine whether it should allow this transaction to go ahead. So we extend this slightly. We say, okay, let's start with the same setup, but we also add a data component to each output. We call it the data script. And also we allow the validator access to the entire transaction which is being validated. And then we get a slightly more complex validity condition where the validator function gets all these components and then determines whether to allow this transaction. Now this is what we call the extended UTXO model. And it greatly increases the expressive power of those contracts. And nevertheless, it's still purely functional, purely local, follows the same data flow model as in the classic UTXO representation. And concrete advantage, well, if we look at this equation for validation, and all these scripts, the redeemer, validator, data script, they're all represented in Pluto's core, This is just a functional expression, and it's a purely functional expression. What did I say about pure functions? Same input, guaranteed to get the same output. It's not just that we guarantee to get the same output in terms of value. Yes, we get the same result if you run this function twice. But we also pay the same execution costs every time. That has a huge consequence. It means we can perfectly predict on-chain execution costs before we even submit the transaction. Now you may think, well, sure, every system should have this property. Well, then have a look at Stack Exchange on the questions people ask about Solidity. You have to submit amount of gas with your transaction, which you don't know whether it's going to be sufficient to run that transaction. And if not, you lose the entire fee and your transaction doesn't go through. And then you can resubmit with more money and maybe you're lucky this time or not. So by design, having this property of purity of execution, our system doesn't have that problem. You always know how much you are going to pay for script execution. So this is how adhering to this functional programming discipline gives us immediate benefit. Not just, and I don't mean to belittle that, easier to reason programs, but there are other benefits as well. All right, so let's look at the third component. What do I mean by full stack? Well, there was a hint about this in the previous talk. So what do we use as a programming language? I'm going on about functional programming types and my bad jokes about Solidity and mutable state. So it's probably not going to be Solidity. We could invent a new programming language. I'm a programming language researcher. I like to invent programming languages for breakfast. There's just, unfortunately, it's very resource and time consuming. It's not just you have to invent the language. That's fun. You have to write a compiler. Well, still fun. You have to test the compiler. Less fun. You have to write documentation, no fun at all. You have to maintain a user pace. You have to talk to people. It just gets worse from then on, right? So there's actually a huge overhead in creating a new language, a huge cost, and takes a long time. Few companies have the resources of Apple that they can go to their developer base one day in the developer conference and say, tomorrow you're going to use a different programming language. And everybody goes like, okay. Now we are 5 years later, everybody's using Swift and no Objective-C. This is hard to pull off. Need a lot of resources. So we thought, well, let's use an existing language. There's Haskell. Haskell is great. It's got it's an expressive, powerful language, expressive type system, lots of libraries, tools, books. People have done all this work I was talking about. People have done this already. Why should we do it again if we couldn't use that language? So that's what we did. So we didn't build a new language. We built libraries and tools in order to use Haskell as the smart contract language on Cardano. So how does that look like? Well, I don't know whether you've ever written Solidity, Ethereum, smart contract, or something like that. So the short story is, first of all, you're writing some Solidity. And if you haven't done this ever, then you might think you're done at this point. No, you're going to write JavaScript too. It's usually more JavaScript. Why? Because the Solidity code, this is what's doing this validation business. And the JavaScript code, this is what's using the Solidity code to actually do something interesting. It's like front and back end of a web app. So actually, you get this two-level architecture, like a front end and back end. And you have this off-chain code running in the use of cryptographic wallet, talking to the blockchain by feeding it transactions. Now, we call this two-level programming model in programming languages, and that's fine. It's only that in this case, it's quite ad hoc. I mean, it's inconvenient. You have to learn two languages. If you have code in one and you need it in the other, you have to rewrite it. You can't just reuse it. It's complex because the connection between the two is some ad hoc protocol via some library, JavaScript library called Web3. And it's fragile. If you change one and you don't adapt the other, maybe you change the number of arguments in a function call, it'll just not work. But you don't get a compiler error message or anything. So it's not very good. So we thought, let's use Haskell for off-chain. And on-chain, maybe also Haskell. Well, actually a subset of Haskell, which we call Bluetooth DX. And then we have a fully integrated system, same programming language. The whole program can live in one module. It's all integrated. It's nice and compact. And it's actually robust because the type checker will check function calls across the boundary for us. So if we add some arguments one side, we forget to add them in the other, we'll get a type error. That's great. So if we have a program written in this setup, Bluetooth, it looks like this. You don't have to read the code. I actually made it small, so you can't read it. If you're a Haskell pro, maybe you want to quickly scan it. But the point is there are two colors, the top bit, the green bit, that's the off-chain code, and the blue bit on the bottom is the on-chain code. It's not that you always layer it like this, but we use a facility for metaprogramming called Template Haskell to embed the on-chain in the off-chain code. And in this little example, there just happen to be two parts. But there could be multiple interleaved parts. And then we have our compiler. It compiles the entire program to JavaScript or WebAssembly, which can, in a platform-independent manner, run in a crypto alongside cryptographic wallet of a user. And that off-chain code, it embeds the Bluetooth core, which is the on-chain code, which I was talking about earlier, which is the system F omega calculus, in which we express all the on-chain computations. And then if the user, say, exercises a function from that contract through their wallet, submitting committing some ADA, some cryptocurrency, then the system submits a transaction to the chain, including some Bluetooth core locking the transaction using this validator setup. And at the same time, the wallets, they observe changes to the blockchain and generate events which then trigger the off-chain component. And so we get a flow working in which we have an interaction between the on- and off-chain components. And currently, Cardano hasn't integrated Bluetooth yet. We are still working on this, and this is our task for this year. Last year, we developed Bluetooth. This year, we integrated. But you can already use it. We have a system called Bluetooth Playgrounds. It's online on the web, or you can download it as a Docker container, and you can write your Bluetooth contract. It can simulate multiple wallets, run it on something we call the mock chain, with a functional simulation of the blockchain. It's a little bit like your private testnet. And it includes some interesting functionality, such as the ability to define new native tokens. So ADA is the currency of Cardano, but you can define your own tokens as native tokens. And you can also model non-fungible tokens, which is interesting in all kinds of scenarios to model permissions or to track off-chain resources, something Fritz asked about earlier. And this is on-chain available at this URL. And thank you very much for your attention.
We have, again, a little bit of time for questions.
Can you tell us a bit about your approach to gas metering in Bluetooth? What do you have in mind? You said that since everything is functional, same inputs and output all the time, it's easier to calculate statically. I guess that's what you meant, statically, how much gas a contract would take. I'm wondering if you started working on that, because to me that sounds like a very interesting problem and non-trivial.
So we don't, we simplify the problem. We don't try to do static analysis to figure out how much gas a contract uses or resource execution costs, which, as you are pointing out very rightly, and you have a lot of experience in that, is a very hard problem. What we use, we directly use the property of Bluetooth Core to be deterministic. So what we do, we actually run the code off-chain, and we measure how much execution costs are consumed. And then that's the amount of cost we add to the transaction. So there's no static analysis. It's not nothing fancy. It's by having this property that the computation always takes the same costs, independent of whether we run it off-chain or on-chain. Because we have this property, we just run it twice, basically. We run it off-chain, measure it. That's the cost we submit. Then we run it on-chain, and we are guaranteed by the properties of the system the costs won't vary. And that's a property you don't have in Ethereum.
Thank you.
So in contracts in the real world, they're actually put in as an intermediary, as like a shared document between you and me or somebody. And there's a careful separation of the document that we have to share and the code, which means my strategy for participating in this contract, and your code of participating in this contract. So the idea there being actually make sure you have a clear separation of this, you know, the shared code, which is the contract, and the private code, which is my, in this case, TypeScript or JavaScript, and your JavaScript. So is this separation still achievable, and how is that supportable in because in Plutus you make it possible to have both combined?
Yeah, so that's a great question. There are actually different usage scenarios. So what you are alluding to is a typical, I would say, enterprise scenario, where we have the common infrastructure, and then we both as organizations have our private infrastructure, which communicates with the centralized one. This is perfectly possible in our scenario. Actually, what these Bluetooth contracts compile to is RESTful web services, which are then used in a microservices setup inside the what we call the application platform, which is this wallet setup. And well, they are just RESTful APIs. You can use them from any network capable infrastructure, and two companies could do that and then not have all the off-chain logic in the initial contract, but only the shared component. But if you look at how smaller entities, if I'm, for example, I want to write a crowdfunding service and I want the general public to use that, then they're not going to write their own code because most of them can't write code. And we should account for this use case too. And in this use case, it's the one developer who traditionally would say write a web app and distribute it to people. In the same way, we write this Bluetooth contract and then we distribute that. And so I think we have to account for both of these scenarios.
Thank you. So thank you again, Manuel.
Thanks. Thanks for having me.